Hachette Audio presents Theft by Finding, Diaries, 1977 to 2002. Written and read by David Sedaris.
For Dawn, Friendship Flower, Erickson. Author's note. Occasionally in this book I have changed people's names or slightly altered their physical descriptions. In some cases, I've changed a name because the person in the preceding entry was also a Jim or a Mary, and I wanted to avoid confusion. How is it that I have so many Steves in my life and only one Thelma? I've rewritten things when they were unclear, or, as was more often the case in the early years, when the writing was clunky and uninviting. Introduction. Not long after deciding to release a book of diary entries, I came upon a 5-pound note. I'd been picking up trash alongside a country road in West Sussex, and there it was, between a potato chip bag and a half-full beer can that had drowned slugs in it. Given the exchange rate, the bill amounted to around $8.15, which, as my mother would have said, ain't nothing. A few days later, I met with my friend Pam in London. The subject of windfalls came up, and when I mentioned the money, she asked if I'd spent it. Well, of course, I said. In the UK, if you discover something of value and keep it, that's theft by finding, she told me. You're supposed to investigate whether it was lost or stolen, though in this case, £5, of course you're fine. Theft by finding. It was, I thought, the perfect title for this book. When it comes to subject matter, all diarists are different. I was never one to write about my feelings, in part because they weren't that interesting, even to me, but mainly because they were so likely to change. Other people's feelings, though, that was a different story. Got a bone to pick with your stepmother or the manager of the place where you worked until yesterday? Please, let's talk. If nothing else, a diary teaches you what you're interested in. Perhaps at the beginning you restrict yourself to issues of social injustice or all the unfortunate people trapped beneath the rubble in Turkey or Italy or wherever the last great earthquake hit. You keep the diary you feel you should be keeping, the one that, if discovered by your mother or a college roommate, would leave them thinking, if only I was as civic-minded / big-hearted / philosophical as Edward. After a year you realize it takes time to rail against injustice, time you might better spend questioning fondue or describing those ferrets you couldn't afford. Unless, of course, social injustice is your thing, in which case knock yourself out. The point is to find out who you are and to be true to that person. Because so often you can't. Won't people turn away if they know the real me, you wonder? The me that hates my own child? That put my perfectly healthy dog to sleep? The me who thinks deep down that maybe The Wire was overrated? I do not think The Wire was overrated. What I prefer recording at the end, or more recently, at the start of my day, are remarkable events that I have observed. Fistfights, accidents, a shopper arriving with a full cart of groceries in the express lane, bits of overheard conversation, and startling things people have told me. These people could be friends, but just as easily barbers, strangers on a plane, or cashiers. A number of their stories turned out to be urban legends, the neighbor of a relative whose dead cat was stolen from the trunk of a car, etc. I hope I've weeded those out. Then there are the jokes I've heard at parties and book signings over the years. They were obviously written by someone, all jokes are. But the authors are hardly ever credited in the retelling. Another thing I noticed while going through my 40 years of diaries is that many of the dates are wrong. For instance, there might be 3 October 1st, 1982s. This was most likely because I didn't know what day it was. Time tends to melt and run together when you don't have a job. In that pre-laptop era, you had to consult a newspaper or calendar to find out if it was Wednesday the 8th or Thursday the 9th. This involved getting up, so more often than not, I'd just stay put and guess. Quite often, I'd even get the month wrong. It might look like my average diary entry amounts to no more than 7 sentences, but in fact, I spend an inordinate amount of time writing about my day, around 45 minutes usually. If nothing big happened, I'll reflect on a newspaper article or a report I heard on the radio. I'm not big on weather writing, but have no policy against it. Thus, when life gets really dull, I'll just look out the window and describe the color of the sky. That will lead to something else most often, a bird being mean to another bird, or the noise a plane makes. Starting around 1979, I began numbering my entries. It's a habit I still maintain. December 28, 2016. 1. It's only December and already. 2. Dad called on my birthday. "I'm trying to visualize where you're living," he said. "Are there a lot of power lines out where you are?" 3. Hugh stormed out of the kitchen yesterday, leaving me, Candy, Amy, and Ingrid, who was in the middle of a story about her mother. 4. I ran into Michael at the Waitrose. 5. Carrie Fisher died yesterday. 6. Hugh just came in and told me. This is what cavemen did before paragraphs were invented, and I'm not sure why I don't just indent or hit the space bar twice. Another old-fashioned practice I maintain is carrying a notebook, a small one I keep in my shirt pocket and never leave the house without. In it, I register all the little things that strike me, not in great detail, but just quickly. The following morning, I'll review what I jotted down and look for the most meaningful moment in the previous day, the one in which I felt truly present. It could have been seeing an old friend, or just as likely, it could have been watching a stranger eat a sandwich with his eyes closed. That happened recently and was riveting. Every so often, I'll record something that might entertain or enlighten someone, and those are the bits I set aside. I thought I'd eventually put them into a book of diary entries, but when the printout reached a height of 8 inches, I decided that maybe 2 volumes, the second of which will cover the years 2003 to 2017, would make more sense. It's worth mentioning that this is my edit. Of the roughly 8 million words handwritten or typed into my diary since September 5, 1977, I'm including only a small fraction. An entirely different book from the same source material could make me appear nothing but evil, selfish, generous, or even, dare I say, sensitive. On any given day, I am all these things and more. Stupid, cheerful, misanthropic, cruel, narrow-minded, open, petty, the list goes on and on. A different edit, no doubt a more precise one, would have involved handing my diary over to someone else. But that is something I cannot imagine doing unless, perhaps, that person is a journalist. They never get beyond the third page, which they usually call the middle, as in, I'd hope to finish this before our interview, but I'm only in the middle. That said, I don't really expect anyone to listen to this from start to finish. It seems more like the sort of thing you might dip in and out of, like someone else's yearbook or a collection of jokes. It wasn't easy revisiting what are now 156 volumes of my diary. I broke the job up a month or two per day, but after reading about me, I'd have to spend the rest of the day being me. I don't know that I've ever done anything quite so exhausting. He would be in the next room and hear me shout things like, "Will you just shut up?" and "Who cares about the goddamn pocket square?" "Who are you talking to?" he'd ask. "Me in 2001, I'd answer. By then I could see the light at the end of the tunnel. The early years, 1977 to 1983, were the bleakest. I was writing my diaries by hand back then. The letters were small and fueled by meth. A typical entry would go on for pages, solid walls of words, and every last one of them complete bullshit. I've included very little of that time in this book. It's like listening to a crazy person. The gist is all you need, really. The diary lightened up when I moved to Chicago, partly because I was in a big city, but mainly because I felt so much better about myself. I'd finally done what I'd talked about doing for so many years. I'd left the town I grew up in. I'd gone back to college and actually graduated. There was all the more reason to feel good when, in the fall of 1990, I moved to New York. I was only writing at night back then, either smashed or getting there. You'd think I'd have addressed my drinking, at least in the privacy of my diary, but it's rarely mentioned. To type that word, alcoholic, would have made it real. So I never recounted the talking to's I got from Hugh and certain helpful people in my family. Similarly, it took me a while in the 1970s to write the word gay. Oh, please, I said out loud to my 20-year-old self while reading my earliest diaries. Who do you think you're kidding? This project made evident all the phases I've gone through over the years and how intensely. Oh, the ink that was spilled over finding the correct phone number of someone who'd obviously, and for good reason, given me a fake one. Over losing weight. Over my French homework. Later, I'd throw myself into catching...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.